Hello viewers, this is Dr. Mozam Tivana here, and in today's lecture we are going to talk about the 3G UMTS architecture. This is our first lecture on this topic, and we would be more focusing on the access network of a 3G UMTS system in this lecture. A mobile network can be divided into three major parts. The first part is the user equipment. The second part is the access network, and the third part is the core network. Now coming to the user equipment consists of a mobile station, and we know very well that only the mobile station cannot use a mobile network unless it has the SIM card. And this SIM card in 3G is also called the universal SIM or the USIM. And this SIM card basically holds the subscriber or the user's identity, which is very important for this mobile station to access its particular mobile network. And in order to access or use a mobile network, we need the to authenticate this user with its network. And for the authentication, we need the authentication key as well as the authentication algorithm, which is also stored in the SIM card. And we also need to encrypt the communication between the mobile station and the node B. So for the encryption purpose, we need the encryption key, which is also known as the, which is also stored in the SIM card. So you can think of a SIM as a database, but on the user side. Now coming to the second part of a mobile network, the second part of the mobile network is the access network. And in access network, we have node B. Node B is the tower to which a mobile station connects. It is here that this mobile station is connecting with the rest of the mobile network via this node B. So that is why we call it as the access network, because here mobile station is accessing the its mobile network. And there can be one node B or many node Bs depending upon the size of a mobile network. And a radio network controller can control one to more than one node Bs. Basically, radio network controller has the intelligence of the access network is in the radio network controller. And a radio network controller can manage and control the node Bs that are connected to this radio network controller. So this access network, which consists of radio network controller and the radio network controllers and the node Bs, is known as the UMTS Terrestrial Radio Access Network, which is also abbreviated as the UTRAN. Now, the interface between the radio network controller and node B is called as the IUB interface. And the interface between the node B and the mobile station is known as the UU interface. And this is an air interface which is based upon the WCDMA technology. So as this interface between the mobile station and the node B is based, this air interface is based upon the WCDMA access technology, so we call these networks are the 3G WCDMA UMTS systems. Now we come to the functions of a node B. Basically, you can consider the node B as a radio transceiver which communicates with the mobile station. And for this communication, it uses the WCDMA access technology. This means that the information bits that this node B is receiving from the radio network controller on the IUB interface, it basically sends that those information bits to the mobile station. And in order to send that, first of all, according to the WCDMA principle, it spreads that information by multiplying it with the CDMA code. And in the second step, it modulates it using the QPSK modulation scheme and sends that information to the mobile station. This means that we need to spread the information bits received on the IUB interface, and then we modulate it using the QPSK modulation scheme, and then we send it to the mobile equipment. And in the uplink from the mobile equipment, the information that we are receiving, we need to despread it and we need to demodulate it. And that information is then passed to the IUB interface and to the rest of the network. And also in the node B, if during the communication there are any bit errors or frame errors, we need to correct those errors. And that error correction is also done in the node B. And on the mobile station side, the error correction is also done for the information that it receives from the node B. Now we come to the measurement report. Suppose this mobile is in communication with this node B. On the information or the bits that it is receiving from the node B, it would be calculating the frame error rate. And this frame error rate would be an indicator of the quality of the communication that is going on between this mobile station and the node B. So first thing that it is calculating is the frame error rate. And the second thing is the power. It would be calculating the power that it receives from its own node B to which it is connected, and also the power it is receiving from the neighboring node Bs. And it would make a report which is known as the measurement reports, which contains the frame error rate and the power of its own base station as well as its neighboring base stations. And it would send this measurement report to the node B. And this node B would then pass on this measurement report to the radio network controller. Both the node B and the radio network controller use this measurement report. How do they use it? We come to it. The node B basically use this information for the inner loop power control. The power of the signal that this mobile station is receiving, that needs to be within a certain threshold. This means that the power it is receiving from this node B should not be that too high that it interferes with the mobile stations in the neighborhood, and it should not be too low that this mobile station receives the bit errors on the communication that it is receiving from the node B. So actually there is a threshold of power at which this mobile station should receive the power. We don't want to have the power which is very above or very below that threshold. So what node B does, that if the power is received by the mobile station is lower than that threshold, this node B would increase its power. And if that power is higher than that threshold, in that case node B would decrease its power that for the communication that it is doing with this node B. So this type of power control is known as the inner loop power control, and it is done in the node B based upon the measurements that it is receiving in the measurement report. And who is making those measurements? Mobile station is making those measurements. Now, the second use of the measurement report is for the handover. As I told you that this measurement report then goes from the node B to the radio network controller. And for example, this mobile is moving towards this node B. So as this mobile station would be moving to this node B, the power that it is receiving from this node B would start decreasing, while the power that it is receiving from this node B would start increasing. And this information is being sent as the measurement report to the RNC, and RNC would decide that, okay, now this mobile station is more near to this node B, so it would trigger the handover to this node B. This means that this mobile station would now connect to this node B. And so this is the second use of the measurement report by the RNC. And here you are also seeing another interface between the two RNCs, which is known as the IUR interface. This what is the use of this IUR interface? This IUR interface is useful. For example, this mobile station is moving from this node B towards this node B, and it was originally in communication with this node B. Now, as this mobile is moving towards this node B, the power it is receiving from this node B is decreasing, and the power it is receiving from that node B, it is increasing. And this means that RNC needs to trigger the handover from this node B to this node B for this mobile station. But in this second target node B is basically connected to this other RNC. So in order to trigger the handover, there needs to be a signaling between these two RNC, and this signaling is achieved by the IUR interface. Now we come to the functions of the radio network controller. What is radio network controller? Radio network controller basically manages and controls the radio resources of the node B's that are connected to a radio network controller. Now, what is radio resources? Radio resources are basically those parameters that are involved in the radio communication. For example, at what power the node B would be transmitting, that power is a radio resource. And also, when a mobile is making handover from one base station or node B to another base station or the node B, then the handover, the parameters of the handover are also the radio resources. So all these radio resources are basically managed by the radio network controller for the node B's that are connected to a radio network controller. And in the previous slide, when we were talking about the functionalities of node B, we talked about the handover, that how the radio network controller is involved in the handover. Then and also we talked on the previous slide about the inner loop power control, in which the base station actually varies its transmit power depending upon the power that the mobile is receiving. If it is very high from a threshold or very low from a threshold, this base station tries that the power received by the mobile station should be near that threshold. So this power threshold is basically set by the radio network controller. Okay, and this power threshold is set, so this means, and this is known as the outer loop power control. So inner loop power control is basically between the node B and the UU based upon the power threshold. But this power threshold is set by the radio network controller so that the quality of communication does not degrade below a certain level. And how does this radio network controller decide their threshold? It is again based upon the measurement report that it is receiving from the mobile station via the node B. And based upon this measurement report, if the quality of communication is decreasing, then this radio network controller would increase the threshold. This means that the node B would be transmitting with more power so that mobile station receives a good quality signal with less frame error or bit error. And also when a mobile, for example, it is in a network, you turned up a mobile, this mobile needs to register itself with the network. So in order to register itself with the network, this mobile will communicate with the network. And now the question comes that at what power this mobile would communicate for the network for the first time. So if it transmits at a very high power, then it is possible that this mobile, other mobile, would receive interference from this mobile, and this is not good. And if it transmits at a lower power, then in that case also its communication may not reach this node B properly. So radio network controller basically tells this mobile that at which power it should transmit for its initial access, to the network. And this radio and this is based upon how bigger the cells are. If the cells are bigger, then this mobile station would transmit at a higher power, because if there is a big cell, in that case this mobile needs to transmit at a higher power in order to so that its communication properly reaches the node B. Now we come to the second function of the radio network controller, and this is known as the admission control. For example, this is a cell, okay, and this is a mobile which wants to initiate a voice call. In order to initiate a voice call, this node B needs to give a CDMA code to this mobile station, or in other words, I can say that this node B needs to give a CDMA channel to this mobile station to initiate a to start a voice call. But there may arise a situation that there are already too many mobile stations in this node B cell area. So this means that there is no room for another mobile. So this mobile would not be admitted to the network in that case. So this decision that a new mobile needs to be admitted in the network, or depending upon if the capacity is always full, means there are no more channels available, this thing is known as the admission control. The decision to admit a new mobile into a cell or not. Now, for example, the cell is not congested. So this means that we want to admit this mobile to the this node B and this network to initiate a voice call. So for that purpose, we need to reserve the resources. And what is the resource that we need to reserve in the case of voice call? That would be the code, that CDMA code that would be allocating to this mobile station, or in other words, I can say that we are the CDMA channel that I am giving to this mobile station. But if we are doing a packet call, for example, I am using Skype, and on Skype I am doing voice chatting. Okay. So for a voice call, I need a low bit rate on Skype. But on the other hand, I want that my packets are not delayed, because if packets are delayed, then the voice call would be horrible. This means that there is a constraint on the bit rate, that we need a certain bit rate, and also we need the packet delay to be a certain, to be within a certain threshold. So this means that I have to do some sort of packet scheduling. So this packet scheduling is basically done in the radio network controller, which this packet scheduling ensures that for this call, a user has a certain bit rate within a certain delay. Okay, packets have no more than a certain delay. So this means that for the packet call, we need the quote allocation as well as we need the packet scheduling for a Skype, for a data call. And the example I gave you in this case is the voice call using the Skype. And all this falls in the paradigm of radio resource reservation. Now, I come to the congestion control, and this is an important function of the radio network controller. For example, this is a cell, and there are many mobile stations in this cell. All the CDMA codes or CDMA channels have been used by these mobile stations. Okay, so in that case, if there is a new mobile that wants to initiate a call, there will be no resources for that mobile station. So what radio network controller can do, first thing that radio network controller can do is to block this mobile. Okay, this can be first solution, but we don't want that. The second solution that this radio network controller is that it can decrease the data rates of for example, FTP traffic. If this mobile is downloading some file, then there is it's a non-real-time traffic. Means if the file delays in 1 minute or it delays in 2 minutes, it doesn't cause much problem. So it can be, this radio network controller can reduce the bit rate of those mobiles which are using non-real-time services. And this would enable this mobile to be admitted into the network. So this is one of the mechanisms of the load control or the congestion control. And the second mechanism can be to trigger the handover. For example, these mobiles, which are actually on the border between this node B and this node B, this radio network controller can trigger their handovers to this node B. So what this would do, this would actually reduce the load on this node B to ensure proper quality of communication, and so that the calls, the incoming new mobile users are not blocked.